Here's what's coming into view on Elevating Denver for November 2023. Go wild with the zoo's tropical discovery.
Anytime you're here, you're going to see something new.
Experience therapy through a shared horse-human bond. And have a look inside the renovated Blair-Caldwell Library.
We really wanted to make spaces where folks can gather and connect.
These stories and more are just ahead on Elevating Denver.
I've always been into kind of the different animals. So reptiles, sharks when I was little. I got a gecko when I was 10 as my first pet. I always liked those different animals. And then when I was an eighth grader going into high school, I went out with a turtle researcher into the field and I was like, oh my gosh, this is great. I love being out in the field. I love finding stuff in the field and learning more and how to help these animals in the wild. And then I got an internship here at the zoo when I was doing my studies at Colorado State. And I was like, well, I want to work at a zoo now. My name is Max Maloney. I'm our lead keeper here in Tropical Discovery at Denver Zoo. As a lead keeper, I do lots of animal care still, but I interact with our supervisors a lot more and pass information back and forth between those two levels. So we are currently in our, what we call our mezzanine of the Tropical Discovery Building. So our building is basically a greenhouse while it is also a display for animals. As it pertains to our building and our animals in particular, having the ability to have live plants grown here and then to put them in displays makes our displays that much better. It gives our animals the opportunity to actually use real foliage, and that means a lot, particularly for our amphibians. Our amphibians like to lay eggs and nest inside of like live bromeliads, and that is something you can't really recreate with a plastic plant. And then as far as the broader zoo, our horticulture team grows a lot of plants here that we call browse, and browse is used, it's plants that get used to feed other animals. So a lot of browse is for our primates, our pachyderms, so rhinos and elephants, and even our capybaras down below us also get that browse. So really, the plants that are grown here aren't just for this building, it's for the whole zoo. So in this building, we have over 300 different species. Now, a lot of that comes from our fish, right? So our fish tanks are absolutely busting with different species. Every tank is a multi-species exhibit. Within our fish hallway, we have a multitude of different, you know, body styles of fish, from eels to puffer fish to angel fish. We have some scorpion fish that look like coral. I mean, we have a lot of really cool stuff. Obviously, the sloths are a big draw. People love sloths, and we, as a team, honestly are a little new to the sloths, and we're very pleased that we now have a full sloth family, mom, dad, and baby. That new display for the sloths is something to always come and check out. And then you get into some of our reptiles and amphibians. Those are also multi-species, a little less so than the fish. For me, one that I really want to highlight off the bat that came to mind straight away is our Orinoco crocodile. So we have two Orinoco crocodiles. One of them is on display, one of them is in back, just because they are big enough we need to keep them separate. These guys I want to highlight in particular because it's such a unique opportunity for zoos in general. It's a project that's across AZA facilities led by Dallas World Aquarium. These guys were hatched in captivity and they're actually gonna be released into the wild. And then of course, Komodo dragons. I mean, Komodos are super, super cool. One of my favorite things about the Komodo dragons are just kind of their actual docile nature and intelligence they display in captivity. We are in the process of getting another male and continuing that breeding project here. So, I mean, Komodos kind of rule one whole side of the building, so they're always a good one to see. just this building alone has more animals than the rest of the zoo. Now, a lot of that comes from our bats and our fish, but still, like as I said, we have 100 plus displays, and that is a lot of species and a lot of different just individual animals that we house here. Another thing with this building is it is so diverse in its collection. So most of us in this building, as you might guess, are reptile, amphibian, and fish people. But as we've highlighted already, we have mammals. We have sloths, we have capybara, we have bats. So just that breadth of diversity, you have to be very flexible in your knowledge set, your skill set, and how to set all these animals up for success and so that they can thrive and be living enriched full lives here at the zoo. The biggest seller for Tropical Discovery is just the amount of animals you're gonna see in here. We have so many different kinds of animals, so many different species, and just sheer number. It's also a controlled environment, so if it's hot out, it's nice in here. If it's cold out, it's nice in here. I'm wearing shorts year-round. It's a beautiful place to be. I just love our building so much. It has so much to offer. Anytime you're here, you're gonna see something new.
We're all connected. There's hardly any industry that you can name that hasn't been impacted and influenced by Black people. And so to have a space that has three different floors whose mission is to celebrate these accomplishments, many of which people don't know about, it's really flattering, it's really humbling, and it's definitely an honor for us.
Elevating Denver visits the historic Blair-Caldwell African American Research Library after highly anticipated renovations due to the Elevate Denver bond and strong community support.
So this year we celebrated our 20th anniversary of Blair-Caldwell as one of five African American research libraries in the country that is tied to a public library system. The community really advocated on our behalf. They knew that we needed to open up these spaces out here on the first floor. They knew that we wanted more spaces to connect with community. You'll find that this renovation has opened us up to a lot more intentionality. We're changing direction with our programming. Traditionally, we focused on mainly adult programming, but we're reaching out to children. We're reaching out to LGBTQ folks. We're reaching out to older adults. Lots of intergenerational things are happening, and we're planning for the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years. One of the biggest pieces of the renovation was incorporating pictures from our digital archives into our study room windows. And so here we have John Mosley and Tuskegee Airmen. Here we have ladies from Lincoln Hills at Camp Nozomi. We have the incomparable and incredible Cleo Parker Robinson. When we renovated, we really wanted to make spaces where folks can gather and connect. Our connection to the community is just extremely important to us, especially for Black folks. We really, really wanted to have something that reflected the history, not just on the second and third floors. And so the major kind of focus point for me for the renovation was bringing some of that history from the second and third floors down to the first floor. And so what I did was I went through all 12,000 titles that were upstairs and pulled out around 800. So one of the pieces of community feedback we received early on was from parents and caregivers saying that they really wanted a space for teens to be able to come and just chill and just hang out. And I think we took that and ran with it for sure. We have gaming consoles. Of course, we have books because we are a library and we do want to introduce teens to printed literature. We have all kinds of spaces and things where they can just hang out. There's no pressure for them to have to be doing anything. They can just be in here and just be and just exist. And we know how important that is for teens, especially that come from marginalized communities. So we try to be very intentional about creating a welcoming space for them where they can just come in here and hang out and just chill out and it's okay. And they enjoy it. It's used almost daily. So this is our redesigned children's space. We do children's programming over here, namely story times, which have been a whole lot of fun. And so even though story time is done throughout the system here at Blair-Caldwell, all of our story times feature Black books, either by Black authors or that have Black characters. And so this is one of our newest spaces, which is our study room A. And this room comfortably accommodates up to 12 folks. And one of the things I like about this room is that it is AV equipped. And this is also the space where we have our Denver Public Library community resource specialists who come in and they meet with folks, usually our unhoused neighbors, they come and meet with and try to connect them to resources. I think that our role as libraries are to be connectors. Even if we can't meet different social and economic needs, we can at least try to connect people to the different resources that can help them. I think the future of libraries, our future is strong. So one thing libraries have always been able to do is to adapt to the times and to adapt to the culture. I think one of the things that libraries have to look forward to is making sure that we are infusing more culture into what we do on an everyday basis. Our country is rapidly diversifying, and so with libraries being one of the last few free public spaces welcoming for everyone, we believe in open access to all. We really need to just kind of nail down ways that we're being much more culturally aware and much more culturally trained and culturally sensitive.
You know, some people don't like Mondays. At the Johnson household, we love Mondays because we get to tell Jake, today is Horse OT Day.
Well, Jake's 26 years old. And when he was born, there was some brain trauma during the birth process. And so he's been globally affected. When he was first born, we were told he might not make it a week or 2 weeks or 2 months or 6 months. And here he is at 26 years old. We do our best to keep him as active as we possibly can with different activities. And, you know, this therapeutic riding is just one of them. We have to be careful when we tell him that Monday is coming up and that therapeutic riding is about ready to happen. Horse OT week, we call it for him. If we tell him too early, he will drive us crazy for about 2 days, continue to repeat, horse OT, horse OT. And so we don't tell him until Sunday night that Monday now, horse OT is about to happen.
Walk on.
Walk on. Let's go all the way around and to the side.
We are at Colorado State University's new Spur campus. My name is Dr. Katie Peters, and I am the Director of Research at Temple Grandin Equine Center at Colorado State University. We have kind of a three-part mission where we're looking to advance education, research, and outreach in equine-assisted services. Equine-assisted services is an umbrella term to describe several different services that incorporate horses in order to benefit people.
So Jake, do you want to do tic-tac-woe or do you want to do basketball today?
Basketball.
Basketball, good, okay.
An example of people who benefit from our services include autistic children. We can put that child on a horse, and the movement of the horse can help that child calm down and be more socially engaged. Young kids who have previously never been able to speak have been known to say their first words while riding a horse. We also work with adults post-stroke. They can come and receive physical therapy on a horse, and the movement of that horse and the way it moves the person's pelvis mimics the natural human gait.
He looks forward to it every week. It's good for him physically, obviously, building that core strength, and then they work on flexibility and all those kind of things. It's something that he just looks forward to every single week.
There's also the social-emotional aspect of connecting with an animal that I think can be really beneficial for some clients. Horses are prey animals. They're really sensitive to human interaction, and we can use that as part of the therapy process. That human-animal bond can be really powerful.
Each client's different and has different goals. We did a lot of exercises today, arm exercises, but we also worked on some trunk rotation.
Nice!
And getting on and off the horse today.
Oh wow, look at that.
The volunteer was very excited because we usually have to physically help get that leg over, and today he was able to do it on his own.
Yeah.
One, two, three.
Up. Perfect.
What they've done here with CSU Spur and the opportunity to impact, you know, those with special needs of some form or fashion, you know, and some of the people that come here are globally affected like Jake is. Sometimes it's more of an internal thing. Other times it's more, even more physical than Jake might have. But it's such an enormous blessing. It's so impactful, I think, because of how it affects the individuals from top to bottom. And so it really is an amazing program, and I think you can see the impact it has on people like Jake.
Jake, are you having a good day?
Yes.
Are you having fun?
Yes.
You having super fun or just a little fun?
Super fun.
Super fun, good.
We actually provide equine assisted services to the general community here in Denver. Part of our mission is to advance the science that supports equine-assisted services. There's a lot of anecdotal evidence that these services are beneficial for people, and the science that does exist shows really promising outcomes, whether that's improved motor skills or improved social-emotional skills or improved quality of life. But if you look at the science as a whole, it's really in preliminary stages of scientific development. So it's our job to help advance that science to be more rigorous and hopefully for that science to direct practice.
Two, three, trot.
It has affected him in such a positive way, enriching his life. So it's amazing what can happen when you get somebody with varying degrees of issues on the back of a horse.
The research we do matters to the public. We here at Spur are very integrated in the community intentionally, and so we try to make our research accessible to the community. If you're interested in participating, contact us and we would love to help get you set up.
So a couple years ago, a reporter interviewed me and asked if you, in all your time in elected office in Denver, if you could only do one thing, what would it be? And I said it was the 5280 trail. You know, making sure that we have a safe way for people to get around our city center is very important to me. You know, I'm a victim of traffic violence myself. You know, I was a runner and a soccer player, and then on August 26, 2008, the Tuesday night of the Democratic National Convention, I was in a crash. I was on a bike and went from being on three soccer teams to being rushed to Denver Health and spending the next few months in a hospital, learning how to sit up in bed. Yeah, so this is a huge change for me, and I don't want other people to experience the same level of traffic violence that I had. So yeah, I was very interested in multimodal transit personally before my crash, before I was ever in a wheelchair. I believe strongly that we all deserve the freedom to get from A to B safely, no matter how we choose to get there. So freedom, safety, access, used to be for cars, but I believe today in Denver we are prioritizing people over cars.
Right now, when we're talking about activating downtown, when we're talking about educating first-generation students, when we are connecting workforce pipeline to businesses, Larimer is the street.
Well, I think in its simplest version, we're replacing a connection that's 68 years old that connects the Auraria campus to downtown Denver, which is the Larimer Street Bridge itself. In a much more complex version, we're not only doing a bridge replacement, but we're increasing mobility options, we're doing green infrastructure to do water quality treatment, and we're doing lighting to create a more inviting, comfortable, and safer environment. Thanks to the voters of Denver that passed the Elevate Denver bond package in 2017, we started and we did a lot of groundbreakings in the first 3-4 years of the program. We're in year 5 now. This is one of many, many ribbon cuttings that are to come.
One, two, three.
This bridge is extremely important. It's 170 years of history for the city of Denver and the very first neighborhood of Auraria. Post-World War II, that was when our soldiers came back. They had the GI Bill. There was a 200% increase in students attending colleges. Every seat in the state of Colorado was taken. Then we had this baby boomer birth rate, and the demographers rang the bell saying, we're not gonna have enough room to educate future citizens of Colorado. And we've got another problem. The city of Denver accounts for more than 50% of the state's population, but we have no public higher education. And that became really the urgency and the complexity behind not only starting great institutions of higher education that are public, affordable, accessible, but then where are we going to house them? They were taking classes in 40 separate buildings in downtown Denver. And that's where we got MSU's mascot, the Roadrunner, because literally students were running across the road. So fast forward, we had to find a location. And Auraria had actually been devastated by the 100-year flood. It was one of 9 sites considered. It took 5 years for Auraria to become the site, several years to build the campus. And we opened our doors in 1976, so the centennial year of the state of Colorado.
When you look at utilization, what we're looking at is 3,000 to 5,000 trips per day across this bridge. And so from a pure utilization standpoint, from a vulnerable road user standpoint, given that a lot of students or downtown residents may be biking, may be walking, this is a vital connection on this west side of downtown. So Dottie touches Denver in a lot of different areas. From the services we provide, from a wastewater, stormwater management, to solid waste collection. We also focus on the transportation of our city. And really what our goal is there is how do we create an environment that encourages mode shift, that gives you an opportunity to travel in Denver just as comfortably as you would in a vehicle, walking, biking, transit, all of the alike. And so we see that as this project as an important component to a much bigger picture of increasing comfort and reducing barriers in transportation.
So there was this ironic cartoon where it would talk about the amount of our public domain that was reserved for the car, and it took that public domain and made it look like a chasm. And it showed, like, you had the sidewalk, and then you had this huge chasm for the car, and then the sidewalk on the other side. And it just showed how much of our public sphere was designed for things that weren't people. It's crazy to think that one bridge could unlock a whole lot of potential, but I believe it is that fundamental, a question and an opportunity.
Well, hello. My name is Izel. And I'm just your average turkey living in the city amongst the hustle and bustle with my sister Chico and all our goat friends. And several other birds and mammals here at the Broken Shovels Animal Farm Sanctuary. As you can see, I'm an incredibly fashionable and independent lady. I know what I want out of life, and living here at the sanctuary provides me the kind of freedom I need to be myself and to be happy. As you prepare for the upcoming holiday feasts, I would like to show you a day in my life and introduce you to some of my other friends here at the sanctuary.
Izel is really strutting her stuff this morning.
This is my friend Andrea. She takes care of us.
If you know any birds in your life, whether it be parrots or chickens or even just the wild birds that you might feed in your backyard, we know that these animals are super intelligent. One of the things that I love about turkeys is they have this incredible ability to recognize and remember different faces, and not just faces of turkeys. I think that speaks to the emotional depth of turkeys and how important familiar faces are to them. They form strong bonds and they love to be with their familiar friends.
Speaking of friends, there are so many of us that are thankful to be here at Broken Shovels. There is Love and Whirly, who are happily married and only enjoy the company of each other. Gandalf and all of the beautiful water buffaloes. Ducks, cows, dogs, and so many birds and mammals. You can say we are one big happy family, and we have a lot of love for the dedicated staff and volunteers.
The mission of the sanctuary is to be a home for animals who become victims of abuse, neglect, hoarding, slaughter, and then on the second part of that is that we create a safe space for humans to come and have meaningful interactions with those animals.
So, Andrea, what are some challenges we have here at the sanctuary?
Anytime you're taking care of large animals, the challenges are plentiful. The big one is, you know, we're working outdoors all the time, so we're very, very weather dependent. We get everything from drought to blizzard to flood, and that is where a lot of the challenge is. The second challenge is the overwhelming need for rescue, and a lot of people consider that farm animals need rescue just like dogs, cats, and any other animal that can be domesticated and not well taken care of. So we fill a vast role for the state of Colorado in being a quarantine space and home and foster home for farm animals of all different kinds. Every year we turn down about 3,000 animals that are offered for surrender just because we are limited by space and budget. And of course, budget is the third biggest part. We're a nonprofit, so we're constantly fundraising. We are very affected by the upturns and downturns of the economy.
I would love to hear about our human friends.
In order to run this facility, we have 3 full-time on-site staff members who care for the animals 24/7. And then we have about 50 volunteers who are here on a weekly or bi-weekly basis.
How can people help our mission?
We are always in need of financial support. We have, through our website, we have ways that you can sponsor specific animals. You can buy us hay, buy us a bag of feed. You can just donate a general amount to our general fund, and then it makes its way into whatever our biggest needs are.
Well, Andrea, I'm incredibly grateful for you and all the work you do. What are you most grateful for?
You know, without all of this community, this sort of widespread, far-reaching group of people who support us, none of these animals could be here. The great thing about me getting to be an advocate is the bigger picture is that I let these animals advocate for themselves. Animals don't keep it a secret when they're unhappy or when they're happy. You know, getting to see a duck splashing around in a pond, getting to see a chicken rolling around and dust bathing and doing what they would do naturally, getting to see goats laying with the best friends that they've had forever. The feeling of gratitude is palpable. Of all these 500 animals here, very few of them had a future where they were going to be allowed to reach adulthood. And here we are, many of them now into their golden years, still thriving, still enjoying everything that they get to do.
Well, I truly hope you enjoyed our time together and learned a few things about turkeys that may have surprised you. We are truly wonderful creatures. Broken Shovels Farm Sanctuary is where people of all ages can come make a meaningful connection with us animals after hearing our stories. We hope to meet you in person at any of our upcoming events. Izelle, signing off.
Stay elevated by subscribing to the city's YouTube page for these stories and more. And stay tuned to our social media channels for more content. Don't miss our new episodes of Elevating Denver, premiering each month. Thanks for watching, Denver.